Hey guys, welcome back to Maxplane Dawn of War Unification. Today's faction guide features the Orcs, the Green Tide, the boys, however you want to call it. The Orcs are very, very special in many ways. I would say they are the most special vanilla faction out of all of the nine. They are lore-wise, I think, fungus, so they are sentient fungus that just grow the ground and walk. In general, they are just make everything work if they want to, if they think of it. They have a very special language that you will notice. So without further ado, we will jump into a game, but not a safe game this time. We will start a small skirmish where I can show you the resources, because they have a special resource. And just make sure that the AI doesn't fight back, and then we start. So, and this is the game. You will notice at the top that requisition power looks pretty standard, and it is also pretty standard. You build squads, cap strategic points, build listening posts, and build generators for power income. One generator generates 10 power. Upgrades are also pretty standard. What is not standard is this red, let's call it resource, at the bottom, and the unit caps. Just start with the easy one. The vehicle cap is from 0 to 20, and you increase it by building war banners, which give you 2 vehicle cap, building a mech shop, which is your unit producing building, giving you another 2, and the bigger mech shop, which is your titan building, gives you 4. In general, you want to have more war banners because it's your how should I say, pop cap, but also your tech. We will talk about it later. What is very special is the orc cap here. The orc cap starts with 15, goes up to 100, and it's directly linked to your war orc resource. In general, the orc resource doesn't mean a whole lot. It is always the difference between your current population to your maximum population. So if I build a few sluggers, you say they take up 4 orc resource, and it will jump automatically here. I think this is just a, how should I say, a mean to make the engine work with how orc pup is used. Orc pup is different than normal squad cap, because it's not that you build a squad and then you can reinforce it as much as you want. Every single orc, for example this slugger, costs you 1 orc squad cap and therefore orc resource. You see, it will go up and it will directly be used, so you cannot have multiple orcs in queue to be ready once orc pop gets free. Orc pop will get free as soon as some unit dies. Once it drops to 0 here, it will slowly go up again, about 1 per second. So it's a little delay before you can spam out your units again. Maybe also this is a reason. As said, you increase your orc resources, your orc squad, therefore your resource. I will neglect the resource in the future. You increase your pop by building a war banner. War banner increases your maximum orc pop by 10. So we need in the end 9 war banners to get to the 100. Interesting about the orc cap is that there are certain buildings. You will notice here, for example, the pylo guns will require 220 orc pop cap, but will only be available once this resources is ticked to 20, or the difference, which will in turn build be 20 then. These units and structures require orc pop cap. They are varying numbers, 16, 29, 21. In the end, you only can increase it by increments of 10. So a requirement of 16 orc cap is by all means the same as a requirement of 25 orc pop cap. Just look at the population caps here in a second while I delete this war banner. You will notice that the vehicle cap, as you would think, drops down to 0 again, but the orc pop cap stays at 25. So the orc pop cap can only be increased, cannot be decreased. When I build a new war banner, it will not increase over 25, So you can only increase it if you have more on the field than you had before, you could say. So to speak, to get the maximum, you will need to have 9 war banners at the field at the same time. Afterwards, you can lose a few, it will not matter. Interesting. I find it really interesting. So you will not lose tech, you can only increase in tech, but if you lose a war banner, I say tech because your pop cap is also sometimes required for tech and stuff, as I stated, you will have to rebuild them before you can increase your tech level again. Yeah, that's about the pop cap and the resources. Did I want to say anything else? In general, I will say here that they are really requisition hungry because of the tech. War banners only cost requisition, so your whole tech to tier 2 and a little onward is requisition based, no power. And in general, your units, your first 3 squads costs you only rec, and your units tend to die a lot because your orcs are, you could say, melee focused. You can play them ranged all fine, but yeah, squishier than you would expect. Okay, that's about the orc cap and resources. We will now jump into the save game for the general overview. And here's the big overview of the orc units and structures. One thing I want to note here before I forget it is that the orc pop cap will be increased by the the cap modifiers of the mod you can have, but the tech requirements for units and stuff will be not increased. So if you use settings that increase the maximum cap, squad cap and whatnot, you will give orcs quite a big advantage tech wise. They can tech up real fast then. Just keep that in mind if you like to play on these settings. Other than that, we will jump here to the buildings first. The buildings are interesting. They are all made of wood and scrap, so they are really not that high HP, but they all have little gun turrets with gretchens inside at varying effectiveness, but in general they are really good, so you don't want to fight them, at least in the first one to two tiers. You don't want to fight within the firing range, which isn't the greatest of the structures of orc. You have your HQ, which starts with 2 turrets and will get, if it's upgraded, which is your tier 3 upgrade guild, more turrets. Standard HQ, get your builder, get some capping units and a lot of heroes in for the orcs. Your generators aren't very special. Your listening posts start off with a gun on top, but the gun itself does almost no damage. It's more of the design. You could say that they have guns everywhere, so it will shoot, but it deals almost no damage. There's the difference to the LP 2, which has a real gun on top and will deal damage, and yeah, is a little more healthy, but in general for listening posts very squishy. And then you have your LP3s, of course. These have a rocket launcher attached to them, so they're anti-vehicle, a little more health, but overall not that much. Range is okay. For defense, you have access to your war banners, so your war banners aren't not only your tech and supply, but also defense. The first gun they have mounted is similar to the of the first listening post, does almost no damage. They can be upgraded relatively late to have a twin-linked shooter turret on top, which will deal actual damage, and then can be upgraded directly afterwards to a rocket launcher, which is really good at defending against vehicles. You could say the range is really, really high. Unit production takes place in these three buildings. You have the Dabois Hut, which is your barracks, has 2 turrets on top, builds all infantry the orc can field. You have the Damag Shop, which also is really straightforward. It builds all the vehicles you can have, include also 1 Squigot, which is your relic demonic unit, you could say. And then you have the bigger mech shop, which is your Titan producing unit building added in unification. For all your research, you have the pile of guns, which is just a big pile of guns. And there you have all the different researches. Orcs have a lot of different researches depending on your playstyle. Let's get quickly over it. I only researched one here for your Storm Boys, but heavy boy armor research basically gives your all your boys, all your infantry more health. So almost get this. It's two staged in tier 3, you can get another stage. Tougher bosses is your commander health upgrade, which has also two stages. More choppy is your melee upgrade, but also gives your squad leaders power claws, so very useful. The first stage, the second stage increases it even more damage, and you have more Dukkha, increasing almost all ranged weapons the orcs have, including these turrets, two stages as well. Blastier research increases the damage of shooters and big shooters of the shooter squad and of the one of the vehicles, the war truck. More burning increases the damage of flamethrowers, two stages. This is only one, and then this is a big shooty boss weapon research increase and gives the Big Mac and the War Boss, which are your primary commanders, better ranged weapons. That's all the research is done here. Some research is done in the boys hut. I will talk later as well as one research here in the mech shop. Okay, so that's the buildings. I have for defense, you also have access to a minefield, which is kind of good. But really expensive in the early game, as the usual 50 power is nothing to laugh at. Okay, so in general, the idea you can do with the orc buildings is that you build little outposts where you have a listening post, for example, then put a war banner next to it, and then maybe a pile of guns, which is good and bad at the same time. Good because you have a little outpost with guns. Bad because if you lose them, because all the buildings, as I said, don't have as much health, you will lose quite a lot of tech and yeah, will probably lose the game as well. Okay, and before we start with the commanders and infantry, Paul, we have to talk about a special infantry mechanic they have going, which is called Orc Mob Bonus, because they will have more benefits in the squad and overall if they have a lot of units in one squad or have a lot of units around. Because in general you would say, okay, if the pop cap is calculated by each individual model, I don't need to have one squad with 16 sluggers, I can also get four squads of four sluggers, for example, which is true. You can micro better, you can have more squad leaders in it, and it's generally preferred, but you get some not to underestimate bonuses if you have like big squads like these, which we will talk about now at the Dawn of War Players Guide page, where it's pretty good explained. And here we are on the player page guide for it, which includes and explains the Orc Mob Bonus. I don't want to be go into the details, you can all read it here. I want to say I don't want to read every sentence here, I just give you the summary. Overall, every single mob, every single orc has a mob value in these variants. As all the standard units, you can say have one mob value, then you have Knob Squatch, which is your higher leader, very tanky tier 2 melee squad, has 2 per model, and then you have knob leaders for your different squads, which also give you 2. Then you have 3 for your Big Mac hero and 5 for your War Boss. This is not always the same as the Orc pop cap they use. Then you have a varying amount of bonuses. These are all the bonuses you can have. The requirements are listed here at the beginning. What they do is in the second row, and then there is only a few units, or for the first bonus it's basically all units, but later there are some units that only are activated by certain units being in the squad. In general, we have the morale regeneration, which is increased by 7% once the mob value is 5. it's not 7%, it's 7% per model. So it is explained here, if you have a squad, for example, of 8 models, 8 sluggers or whatever, you multiply it 1.07 times 1.07 and so on, which is basically to the power of 8, and gives you a bonus of 72, almost 72 morale regeneration bonus. So it's not 7, it's 7 times the exponential for the squad mob value. So it's only for one singular squad. Morale immunity. Now it's interesting. That's the only bonus that is not squads exclusive. You need a mob value of 3 within a radius of 20. 20 is, how should I say, it's a little lower than a standard bolter range. So it's quite a large area, and 30 mob value you get real quick if you have a few squads within. So they get all morale immune. These bonuses are true for all orcs except the builder units. Then you have here the maximum health. You need a 5 mob value in the squad and 50 pop cap, which is and a pile of guns. So you have some tech requirements for that. So it's basically tier 2. The entire squad gains 2% health for each squad member. So this is again multiplied or to the power of the number of squad members. It's only active if the Big Mac is in the squad. So if the Big Mac is there, they gives everyone a little burger and they get more healthy. Healthy in quotation marks. Then you have health regeneration, which is activated if you have a mob value of 5 in the squad. Only true for Slugger Boys, which is your standard capping melee unit. And also the Big Mac gives this bonus if he is attached to the squad. This is a little bugged. It is not multiplied, but every unit gets a 12% health regeneration once this is active. It's not multiplied, and it's also not affected by affected units that don't have this effect inert. So other units than the Slugger Boy and the Big Mac will not get this bonus. So if a War Boss will be attached to a Slugger Boy squad with a value of 5 and higher, he will not get the health regeneration, but only the sluggers themselves. Another big one is the movement speed bonus. It's also activated by a mob value of 5 and tier 2. The entire squad gets 1.5 movement speed. True for a lot of squads, but not for your shooter boys, for example. Your sluggers, your knob leaders, okay. I thought it was the knob squad mentioned here, but okay, knob leaders, storm boy bonus, flash kids, Big Mac. So quite a lot of units get the movement speed bonus, not all. 1.5 doesn't sound much, but if you get chased by a horde of orcs, every 1.5 to the power of, I don't know, 10 will be more than you would like to have. And then the last one is also pretty nice, damage. Everybody likes more damage, so it's also by mob value of 5 and tier 2, so you want to attack with orcs. The entire squad deals 2% more damage per model, so it's like again to the power of whatever you have. So all orcs except Gretchens and shooter boys and knobs. Maybe because that would be insane, the mob value of knob squads gets really high, because I have 11 knobs in one squad times 2, you have a big bonus. It's same for the shooter boys, maybe because the shooters can be really spammed and have the highest range for the orc infantry, so it can be a little overpowered, maybe. And here's also a nifty little table which gives you an overview which unit gets access to what bonuses. In general, you see that morale regeneration and morale immunity is have all damage, is also almost all movement speed. Seems to be more in the melee side, but also on flash kits. So yeah, very special. And health regeneration, maximum health, is only true for the Big Mac. Health regeneration also for the Slugger Boy. So you can see the Big Mac has all the bonuses and will also give the bonuses to the squad he's attached to, except for the health regeneration, that is. Okay, so maybe a lot of information. Long story short, get your mob value at 5 or higher if you want to have your benefits. So if you're a tier 2 and spam Slugger Boys with only 4 members, which they start off, which is a valid strategy, give them the knob leader preferably, so they get a mob value of 6, so they get all these bonuses activated. In general, it is still better to have more squads with medium-sized squads, you could say, than have one big squad of 16 sluggers, for example, because of micro reasons and how pathing works in this game. So if 16 sluggers want to engage melee combat, it takes quite a while. If you have two squads of 8, you can micro them better, can tie up two squads and whatnot. So it's still better to have more squads, but so you know there's a mechanic behind it that wants you to play as orcs and be a big mob that runs at the enemy. So knowing that, having that in mind, we will now talk about all the different units the orcs can field. Okay, now we are back in the game and let's talk about units. The first unit I will talk about is the Gretchen. It's the worker unit, starts up with one model, can upgrade for free to 5 models. Just for your general knowledge rememberment, or you didn't know that, the building gets faster if two units build the same building, and units is meant for models. So if you have a model, a squad of 2 Gretchens, it's enough to build at maximum speed. For repairing, it's 3 models. You can repair at maximum speed if you have a squad of 3 Gretchens. The other 2 are just for, yeah, survivability, you could say. As they are free, you can just always reinforce them to the maximum. You will also notice that they are invisible. The invisibility is a research you can get right from the get-go. Can be nice to keep repairing while in the fight without losing your Gretchens, or even building buildings at the face of the enemy without the Gretchens being shot at. Let's talk about heroes next. The heroes are, the first hero you can field is the Big Mac. The Big Mac is a hero you always want to have on the field because he is very versatile. He can pack a punch in range and melee. He can teleport, and not only him but also the squad he is attached to. And with an upgrade, he can get a tank supper, which is an AoE EMP for vehicles. And with the same upgrade, he gets an aura, which is here, which decreases range damage by 10%. While I'm here, I forgot that almost all orc buildings can garrison units in. The settlement can, the boy's heart, basically every unit, every building except the generator and the bigger mech shop and the war banner. War banner can only have Gretchens in, right? No. Okay, the war banner cannot, but your listening post can. This is not connected like the IG buildings, but it can be nice to save some units if need be. But I wanted to show here that the teleportation for the big map is also for the squad he's attached to. Really, really useful in the early game to have some sluggers around for harassment, or the later stages having nobs and other melee squads to jump around. He can also repair, which is quite useful. The tier 3 heroes you have access to, one is Mad Dog, which is kind of like an weird apothecary. You can get up to 3 or 4 out of the field. They have a regeneration aura and a regeneration... it has a regeneration aura around them, but the squad he is attached to will get a bigger regeneration. They have the fighting juice, which is basically a I cannot die button. You can use that on the any squad in range, not only the squad he's attached to. Makes the units unable to die, so best used if you receive big chunks of fire and want to survive. Once it's over, you will die, but I think the duration is like 20 seconds, so it's quite a while. And last one is the Burma Bomb. And a Burma Bomb is pretty much what you would expect out of an orc. You will place a bomb, and if you don't kill it at 600 HP, which is quite a lot, it will explode, dealing friendly fire, of course. As you can see here, the Mad Dog died. The other hero you have access to is the Warlord. I have the War Gear option on, that's why he is stacked like that. Normally he isn't that big. He is big, but not that big. Really good at melee, preferably. Has quite a lot of upgrades. One of the upgrades is the banner here, which increases the squad cap, which is basically a tech upgrade. Really nice to have in the campaign, if you ask me. And he has an shout, which increases the speed and damage of all units around and also makes them immune to morale. More friendly units. Units are immune to morale and receive a damage bonus. Yeah. We'll shout and use it on the squads around. When he goes to the squad again, it's not an aura around him, it's only one shout at the beginning. And the hero that got added in Unification is the Weird Boy. The Weird Boy is a Psycho unit which has his brain open here, so really tasty, and has a lot of different abilities. I think the teleportation is also again with his squad attached. We will find it out. Okay, we will wait a bit. Maybe it does not. He has an passive ability. Increases the attack rate of nearby infantry squads, allowing to chop more slashes. So it's an attack speed bonus, which is also affected not only melee as it states, I think, but also range squads. Yeah, he has the same teleportation ability as the Big Mac. He has one, how should I say, toggling ability, maniacal seizure, which he cannot use when he's attached to. Let's see again. All affected infinite demons and commander units suffer more damage from enemy attacks and deal less maximum damage. So he will be unable to move and stuff, and will have this little potion here and debuff enemy units. Other than that, he has three more abilities. He has the Roar of Morgue, which is a little fire cone ability here. He has the Fist of Gorg, which is a buff ability which increases the damage and armor penetration of units around, both melee and ranged. Yeah, brief but devastating attack. He's like gives this bonus here around. And then you have the Crunch, which is a tug of ability on the ground, which immediately causing crushing damage to all units underneath. Disorientation. So we will see. Does it friendly fire? Does no friendly fire. But it's a big chunk, you could say. Yeah, here, also the fist, the foot of Gorg. Really nice, really nice. Good focus on details here, I like it. Yeah, that's the Weird Boy, very useful tier 3 unit, can be attached to squads, and yeah, very good at ranged squads, if you ask me, because of the attack speed bonus. That's all the heroes. Let's talk about the infantry. And the first infantry we want to talk about is the Slugger Boy squad. The Slugger Boys are your first teching and melee focused unit. Gets burners after one war banner. Burners are okay, but are ranged and you want to use them in melee preferably. You can get a Nob Leader here. One thing I want to talk about Nob Leader, because he will be coming up later as well. You will sometimes see Orc Pro players standing in ranged and shoot, even if they have Slugger Boys or Knob Squads or whatnot. The Knob Leader has the similar damage ranged in melee against most armor types, but especially against buildings. He has more damage with the Slugger than with his Chopper. So in killing especially listening posts and generators and whatnot, he is better used in ranged stance. So that's why you will sometimes see players using their melee squads in ranged. Only as I say, useful if you have the Knob Leader. And if you, for example, also get the Ducker research. Then you have in tier 1 as well, in tier 0 you could say, as soon as you can build the boys out, which is immediately, you can get the Shooter Boy squad, which is boys with shooters, so it's a ranged squad. Also can get a Knob Leader, which is the same model as for the Sluggers, and they can get big shooters later, which is basically heavy bolters. The range normally is, I think, the same as a standard bolter, and the range of a big shooter is then more of a heavy bolter or a little lower. You'll see them poof getting it, and the range is a little higher now. Also a tier 1 unit, but a little later in the tech tree is the Storm Boys. You could call it a tier 1.5 unit. The Storm Boys are your jump troops, tanky, and also a Knob Leader, which does look different than the Knob Leader here, but the stats is, are pretty much the same, except he can jump, of course. They can jump around, they can use stick bombs as long as you have the pile of guns, which is basically a grenade. Boom. Does a little AoE damage and some knockback. And what is the most important upgrade once you got it is the turbo boost. Let's jump over here maybe. And you see they are really fast to begin with, so if they move even through the negative cover here they should be quite fine. But if I activate turbo boost, it's just like maniacs coming at you. And this is really important for a melee squad because they want to close to distance and attack you. So for chasing around ranged units that want to run away, this turbo boost is really, really helpful. Needs to be researched though. That's your tier 1 units. In tier 2 you will have access to a Knob squad, which is basically a squad full of these Knob leaders. You could think of it, the stats are a little different, the models are like that. Only the Knob leader itself is really a Knob leader as the other squads have. The others have similar stats and health and whatnot, but aren't really the same, you could say. It's they are a little weaker. In general they are really strong, need two pop cap each model, so they are need to be careful with them, but they are really, really tanky and have a punch in melee. Most used for the tankiness, can have up to two squads on the field at the same time. The tank busters are your anti-vehicle units in tier 2. They have rocket launchers, a squad size of 5, so you can target down different vehicles with them. They can also get an infiltration research, which makes them really, really useful. Should get it as soon as you can. Basically get one or two squads out of the field if you need them, and then get the upgrade right away. It's quite a fast upgrade, but you want to have it around. It can later also be used to tie up any ranged squads in melee if there are no detection around and you don't need to focus vehicles anymore. One unit that is almost tier 3 but is not are the Mega Armored Knobs. You can also think of them as a little commander squad because they have commander armor. They have okay damage, quite a lot of health, but are really slow. They can but use the power surge, which gives them a movement speed bonus, but that loses them 10 health per second, so it's quite a lot. If you want to use that, you want to have a, what is it called, a mad dog around to have some regeneration going, or you are just fine with them losing some HP for them being at the front where you have want to have them be. Your tier 3 squad, infantry squad, is the Flash Kids. The Flash Kids don't have any special abilities, they can just shoot. And shoot, they do real good. They have these custom shooters dealing a lot of damage. Sound is also really nice. Up to two models, two squads of them are capable to be fielded at once, and you want to have both if you can. A new squad added in Unification is the Commandos. The Commandos are infiltrated, how should I say, sneaky hybrid squad. They have melee, good melee damage, but also range, but can also get some special weapons, can get a Knob leader as well, can get different bombs. They have stick bombs if your pile of guns is around, so it's the same requirement as for the Storm Boys, but they can also get tank buster bombs, which are targeted anti-vehicle and anti-building bombs. The description states of this squad that they have more bombs the higher the mob value. I suppose this is meant that they have a little cooldown reduction the higher the mob value is. So max them out as you would normally want to have, give them their Knob leader, and yeah, attaching units to them is not a good idea, because if you attach a leader which is not infiltrated, which is basically all leaders of orcs, the infiltration of the squad gets broken. It states also that they move a little slower while infiltrated and will get the full movement speed once they get detected. So, little interesting mechanics here. You will also notice that these guns doesn't look that fancy, but if you get them, they look a lot better. So the flamer is not just a little can here, but like a little real gun. The rocket launcher looks nice, and where's the big shooter? Here, the big shooter looks also pretty nice for them. So Yeah, they're really versatile in what they can do. I normally use them either as the big shooters for anti-infantry, so it's like a third flash kit squad with a little less damage, but infiltrated, or with the rocket launchers to have a high health tank buster, you could say. If you want a something against morale, like if you're playing against demons and stuff, you can also give them burners, of course. That's the infantry out of the way. Let's talk about the vehicles. The vehicles aren't that many for the orcs. You have, these are your standard vehicles, you could say. You get it in tier 2.5 once you get your mech shop. The first two units you can build are war tracks and war trucks. Don't mix them up. They have a turbo boost ability, both of those. The war trucks is your transport vehicle, really fast. Can get an movement speed increase via an upgrade to the big mech, the mech shop. And it's really fast, yeah, but pathing is always an issue, so you will know that this will get stuck at some point. The war track is a really versatile unit, you could say. It's really fast, you can also get used to turbo boost, has two rockets attached to begin with, but you can also get a bomb chucker, which is also in vanilla, so it's an artillery anti-infantry. Don't really call it artillery, because the medium to long range is true. It doesn't have, it's, if you count it as artillery, it is the lowest range artillery in the game, I think. And then with unification, you can also get access to a twin big shooter, which is a rather long range big shooter for anti-infantry. The weapon of the war truck is also a big shooter, but yeah, I think these are a little smaller in size, so they can don't get stuck as easily. And supposedly the damage of this gun is a little higher than the damage of the war truck, but these numbers here, the 216 to 246, is probably not accurate to these numbers, so it's it looks like it's double the damage, but I don't think that is the case. Shortly after building another war banner, you can get the killer can, which is a walker vehicle, which has a shooter here, or is it burner? It is a big shooter, I guess, and this little yeah, nasty looking melee weapon here. Can get a rocket launcher in tier 3, I think, so can be anti-vehicle. Doesn't look really impressive, but the most important thing about this unit is that it has the same armor class as a Land Raider or a Baneblade or a Monolith. Activated Monolith, that is. So it's vehicle armor high, so these guys are tanky, so you will need dedicated anti-vehicle if you want to stop these guys. Expensive, but as I stated, very very tanky. In tier 3 you get access to your flyer unit, which is your fighter bomber. The fighter bomber has a little thing on the back. I don't know if it's a weapon that really shoots at enemy, but what it does has is these bombs here, really long range bombs that explode. Very good infantry. You can, you see the range. Let's see how far. Yeah, okay, it's really really far. Range accuracy is okay-ish. Can field up to two of those, and you can park them where the enemy does not will not be able to kill them. So very very good artillery unit. Best, let's say the most mobile artillery unit you can think of. In tier 4 you get access to the looted Lehman Russ tanks. These are basically your Lehman Russ tanks with battle cannon, bolters everywhere, and yeah, can have up to two on the field. That's your vehicle units, the standard vehicle units. Let's talk about your relic units. The relic units are, let's talk with the standard relic unit, which is your Squiggoth. Your Squiggoth is a demonic unit which can but also be repaired. Repaired, has some guns on top, can get some units in the belly to transport, or not in the belly, in the transport stuff at the top, and can also use a rampage ability, which looks really nice. It does some damage and AoE knockback round. Can get stuck at bigger units, I think. The new relic unit added in unification is the Stomper. Stomper is a big walker vehicle which has quite a nasty guns. Long range, you can say. See here, can we attack ground? Ah, with his is he attacking now? Okay, yeah, so this little gun on an appropriate squad, you could say. So, yeah, looks really mean. Can also transport units, as the bigger vehicles tend to. You can only have the Squiggot or the Stomper on the field. Most people seem to prefer the Stomper right now. And then we have here, last but not least, your Titan class unit, which is your Gargant. The Gargant is basically an upgraded version of the Stomper, has even longer range, can also transport units, is slow, but tanky with 1800, so big, big guns, belly gun two at the side, can poop out mines. If you say lay mines, he poops out mines on the field, really cheap. I don't know why, maybe as a melee defense mechanism. He can also use the super chargey force field, which gives him, makes him almost immune to damage to a very short amount of time. Just look at him go. And then you have the Juggernaut. While Juggernaut, he will unstoppable, pushes everything back in his path, enemies will also surely damaged. Speed increase, but weapons are unavailable. So it's he will walk faster and push units around. Also a melee defense mechanism, but he cannot fire while using it. So yeah, interesting. Combined with the force field at the same time is interesting, you could say. You could also just run through the enemies, poop mines in their face and laugh. I don't know. Really, really awky unit, to say the least. So I think that's about the units. Next up, we will jump into the tech tree, where I will explain to you how tier 2, for example, is defined for orcs. And yeah, it's because of the Warburners a little, I wouldn't say convoluted, but yeah, you will see. You will see for yourself. And here on the tech tree document, stated earlier, I want to show how the tech works. Tech is very much linked to the orc population and to some special buildings. So I have, how should I say, combined all the different pop requirements. As I stated, like 16 is the same as 25 because you start with 15 and get plus 10 for one war banner. So I have this requirement to build one war banner, which is all the different upgrades here, for example, and to build the pilo guns. Then if you build another war banner, then you can build, get your storm boys and these upgrades here. And then if you get, have a pile of guns and two, you can get this and so on and so forth. With your tier one is your settlement, of course, does not have a big stuff going on. Only the generator really needs the settlement. Your tier two is when you build the fourth war banner, basically 50 supply, you could say 50 orc pop cap is tier two, because then you can get your vehicle producing building, the mech shop, if you have also the settlement and a pile of guns. So your mech shop then can be built, as well as your, where is it here, your bigger generator, which is all for all the different factions, also tier two, as well as your requisition and power upgrades. So it's basically tier two. Tier two squads, have stated earlier. Yeah, then tier two is also the these mech suit squad here. And to get to tier three, you will need to have 4 plus 2 additional war banners and a boysart or a pile of guns. Tier 3 then is the upgrade of your HQ. In tier 3 you get also the access to the upgrades of the war gear for the war boss, all researched in the mech shop. Interesting to note is that your which is kind of standard. You can only research your upgrades for requisition and power only in tier 3. But which is very important or interesting to see is that you can only upgrade your listening post to the third stage only in tier 3 as well, which is normally for other factions a tier 2 thing to upgrade your listening posts again. So interesting to note here. So if you want to increase your income, you will need to get the research other than increasing your listening posts, upgrading your listening posts a second time. Most times in PvP, you won't upgrade your listening post a second time because it's really expensive and doesn't provide you as much requisition increase as you would like. And yeah, losing them is really, really a dead sentiment. And also, it's like 250 requisition and 150 power-ish for all the factions. And you can think yourself what units you can get for that same cost. Your tier 4 is a research in the mech shop, and for that you need your tier 3, of course, your Oki Fort, it's called, and 5 banners, which is kind of funny because you need 6 banners to get to the Oki Fort. So basically you need your Oki Fort and then you can research it right away. In tier 4 you get access to your higher vehicles, as I stated, and to the bigger mech shop. And yeah, your Gargant has some requirements. I have forgotten something here. Some requirements other than relic and a critical location, but these are all met when you're here. One research I forget to talk about in game is this tier 4 research, which makes sluggers free to build. They only need orc squad cap. So you can, if you have some free population, just build sluggers and send them to the front as a little distraction. Other than that, I talked about all the buildings here. Let's look over to the units. So I have this mob bonus is the war bonus, you could say. So it's a passive war to all the units that provide and receive war bonus here. Basically all the infantry units, you can say, except Kretchens. Yeah, weapon requirements differ a bit from the different units. In general, you could say that you need 2 war banners and a pile of guns for your knob leaders. Some knob leaders require a little more, but these are lower requirements or the same requirements than the squad itself, so no problem there, I would say. Here's also a line missing, I see. Little hiccups here and there. Yeah, that's pretty much it. Okay, I did not told you that this Foot of Gork ability of the Weird Boy has quite a big population cap requirement. I think it's 80, so you need 7 war banners to use it. You have 6 already because you want if you want to get tier 3, you want 6, then you can build them, and if you want to use these abilities, you want to have another war banner as well. Your Honor Guard bonus units are sometimes a little special, sometimes not. Your heroes are pretty straightforward. Your doc you get in campaign only does not have this bomb ability. Other than that, he is pretty much the same. The sluggers, a little minor difference is that they can get the burners right away instead of having to build one banner. So meh. But that's okay. What else is important? The shooters. I didn't know how to put it here, but these shooters you get in campaign is a squad of 4 models, and they have all big shooters right away attached, so you don't need to research them. And also, if you reinforce them, you get the big shooter for free, you could say. One thing to note about all the infantry you get in campaign, they do not cost orc population cap. Also, if they die and you reinforce them, they don't take up orc pop, which is really nice. The knob squad is a little disappointing. It is a squad of only 2 and can get a knob leader, so we have a squad of 3. It's okay. The vehicles are pretty much the same here, and the last one, the Lehman Russ and Squickouts is for survival only in tier 4. Okay, I will clean this a little up here, and you will have the PDFs in the drive all fine and dandy. And now we will talk about the build orders as the usual. And here we are on the build order document. I have prepared quite a few build orders for you, but the most time I want to spend at this build order here, because it's the standard, and it's the standard for various reasons. Because it is the biggest reason, it is very, very flexible. The first buildings you, the first units you will get here at the start are no commitment for anything. So it's different to other factions, where if you build something at the start and decide you want to go with that, you're stuck with it. You cannot build just another barracks or so, because you don't have the resources for it. You will always start with a boy's hut. You will always then get a generator or a war banner, and preferably a generator. You get two sluggers and another Gretchen for capping and building. You get a shooter squad right out of your boy's hut. This shooter squad will not just run to the enemy, but cap one point, preferably before going. So it will also give you time to get a big mech out of the field. So you can just start harass with these two squads, where while these two squads take over the map. You can also combine them with the army, which is takes a little more micro. And can make a little push at the beginning to deny the enemy a point on two. Then you want to tech up a bit. You want to get a war banner or a generator, depending on what you are missing. You want to upgrade your listening posts, A for defense, and B, as I told you before, you want a lot of requisition, because your tech and your units are really requisition heavy. Then after the first banner, you want to get your pile of guns and build a banner while this is building, because the armor upgrade you want to always have, you need two banners for it. So you immediately start the armor upgrade. With that, you also can get big shooters for your shooter squad. And then you have a little to decide if you want to have storm boys or shooter boys. So you can go for one or the other. The standard one would be to get a storm boy out of the field and give him a knob leader immediately. Depending on your decision, if you go for more shooters or more melee, you will get a blastier or choppy upgrade. And you can also get, which is not stated here, can get a ducker upgrade, which is almost always useful. You always want to get, once you have your squads you want to play with on the field, you want to get these special war gear, special gadgets, I think it's called, for the Big Mac, which gives him the vehicle stun, but most importantly the 10% range damage reduction aura. So really, really useful. Yeah, and then you just build generators and war banners as you need to get more power. So you want to have two generators going into tier 2 and some war banners, so you can upgrade your listening posts and start either getting knob squads and tank busters, or go into vehicles. So you can also scrap a few infantry here if you want to go a faster tier 2. So this is also how should I say, also a good option with this build order. Very, very flexible. You will not commit to anything all in or whatnot. That's something that Shakma actually wanted me to tell you, to make it clear that you have not commit. So this is why 80-90% of org games start like this. You can also build, you can vary it a bit. You will see this variation later where it's a little more competent. You can get three sluggers and get your Big Mickey right away and skip the shooters and have no shooters but a slugger, so it's more melee focused. I have a melee focused build order here as well. One builder which is, how should I say, is more a little more dedication than here is to get to the shooter boy spam. The shooter boy spam basically starts the same, but you then will add two shooter boys with all big shooters and a knob leader and whatnot, and get all the upgrades, including blastier and more ducker. You still want to have armor because, yeah, your orcs will die like flies if you don't have that. One thing I forgot to note here is that you can and should get a Gretchen infiltration upgrade at some point. Other than that, it's pretty similar to this, but a little more refined, you could say. If you follow it, you will have three shooter boys. And then you have here the melee focus, which is makes more use of the slugger. So you get three sluggers on the field and then get your Big Mac right away. And then later add two storm boys with knob leaders and the choppy upgrade, which gives the knob leaders a power claws. Very, very useful. And also get the Ducker upgrade, because as I told you, the knob leader of even of the melee squads does more damage to building in range damage, and increasing this range damage with more Ducker is useful. It also increases the damage of all your buildings and whatnot, so it's a cheap upgrade with good effects. I think 15% more range damage. Now it comes a little more obscure. We have a slugger spam, which I made good use against the AI. The idea behind this is that you have some spare resources because you don't build a boy's hut and get a pile of guns earlier. You get add more sluggers, keep them at four, maybe five squads, and then give them all knob leaders, which is something I need to add here. They want all knob leaders and the choppy upgrade. So you have a lot of squads, low unit count, but with knob leaders with power claws. If they are all around themselves, they are morale immune. As I told you before, a 1330 mob value, so really, really nice. And with four banners, you can have up to seven sluggers with a knob leader. That's why this is. I need to add the knob leader here for clarification. Then I have added a little tier two rush, which is not the best because orc really rely on the infantry, so you normally don't want to skip that, but you can get two generators because you want to get vehicles later on, so you start with generators. You can get another, you can skip maybe one generator, but I would suggest two. Get two war banners, but this is all your starting resources. You skip a lot of upgrades and stuff, only get two sluggers and a Gretchen. Build a pile of guns, get the two upgrades here, Shootier and Ducker, which will increase the damage of your war trucks, and I supposedly also the big shooter of your war tracks. So really, really good. Get two more banners and then get the mech shop. So this is only meant to rush vehicles. Your infantry will be really, really bad because you don't even have a boy's hut here. And the last one is a really meme. You can only use it against if you're like medium to bad level and against the AI maybe. It's a settlement rush. The idea is that you build a settlement at a key location to secure more resources for you than for the enemy, and maybe just tilt the enemy. Only useful also on small maps, of course. The map I used it against the AI most effectively was Quest to Triumph, where there's only one entrance to the enemy base. If you're fast and build the settlement there, the enemy is basically trapped in his base and you can take the map. So you will need one generator because you start with 100 power and you need 150. And you will also want to have your Gretchens infiltrated, of course. So your first Gretchen builds the power generator, runs to the enemy base. You get two sluggers, then get the upgrade. So the Gretchen will start building the settlement at the enemy point/points and gets infiltrated soon after he starts the settlement. The settlement takes a whole long to build. You won't have resources to build your listening post at your base right away. And you also need more Gretchens to be able to build these listening posts and further buildings, because your first Gretchen is busy building the settlement for quite a while. Then I played it that way, that I built all the buildings you see here close to the settlement to make a little big orc outpost, like the boy's hut, get some shooters because you want to be in the safety of your settlement. So you build shooters and the Big Mac, give them big shooters, so it's a little shooter spam. Right after that, get generators and war banners, get all the upgrades you want, get to tier two. It's a meme. Don't expect to win using this, to be honest. Okay, that's pretty much it. I will adjust the tech trees here a bit, this in particular, to show that you want to get the knob leaders here, and upload it to my drive. And we will finish this guide as usual with a small replay. And here on the replay, where we see Shagma, aka number 6567, playing the Orcs versus none other than GetPR playing Imperial Guards. You will stick with Shagma's point of view, of course, and you will see this is the standard opener, getting a Boy's Heart and a Generator, two Slugger Boys, a Gretchen, and you will get a Shooter, a Boy Squad, and the Big Mac over here. One little thing you will notice, he will finish the Boy's Heart, get the Shooter Boys. These Gretchens will work at this generator for a moment, but as soon as the Gretchens come out here, or as soon as they can build a listening post here, they will abandon this, and they will continue building the plasma generator. A little small detail, but it allows you to get a little faster listening post out, because these take a little while before they get a second model. You get a 33% increased building time, so you get requisition faster than your power, you could say. You will see here that the Shooter Boys will get a strategic point close to them, and the Big Mac is almost here as well. Other than that, you want to get your listening posts up and upgrade even one or two in the beginning. You have enough power to upgrade at least one, so you should choose a strategic, or better, a safe position to upgrade one to get the maximum requisition out. Early aggression of GetPR here. He will try to prevent the cap of this relic here. He kills two Shooter Boys. This is really painful, but as soon as this is up, it should be upgraded. Oh, he did upgrade one. This one, okay. Should still be upgraded, he does. And then he needs to use his Big Mac here to shoot the command squad. And yeah, these Slugger Boys are just here to buy some time and now want to retreat. Shooter Boys can't be reinforced because you need pop cap. One he could go, but okay. He's also here with the Slugger Boy, at the same time harassing the conscript, four conscripts here. So equal trade, would say, in a little favor of Shagma here, because he has 1 point more captured already, and now deals quite a lot of damage to the command squad. The listening post, the upgrade, the listening post here was a good decision. He should now proceed to get a war banner, which he does, and get this point here, and then start from here. Retreating here is a good point, because now there are two squads, so just run away. You've been annoying, and then yeah, get the critical locations now. The only squad he can be aggressive with is the Shooter Boy squad here now, but in the back he prepares. Okay, he goes two war banners. Normally want to get war banner, pile of guns, and then another war banner, because then you have your pile of guns earlier and can start your upgrades earlier. This is a bad position here. Shagma, and he will teleport out. Okay, he makes a dual pronged attack here to try to again stop Gap from capping his points. He will be able to cap this, but will he get a decap? Yes, he will get a decap. The heavy bolted turret here is in danger, but now Gap can be with it. He did decap, but lost a whole squad of sluggers. I'm not sure if this was worth it in the end, but a lot of economic damage done to Gap PR. He now gets the pile of guns. You see here he is more of a friend of a defensive positioning. You see a lot of players getting the pile of guns and one war banner here, which is okay. Never get it here, this is too exposed. That's kind of okay, but still can get sniped. He adds a Storm Boy squad, which is really needed against Imperial Guard, especially if you have already lost one of your slugger squads. You want to tie down these pesky guardsmen. Good timing. Even gets a second Stormboy squad, and you see what I told you, the Stormboys also only cost requisition. So really nice to have them out here. They need to start moving, or does he want to wait until he has two? Gets the armor, as I stated earlier, and gets the Knob Leader. They won't have the Power Claws yet. You need to have 40 Pop Cap to get the Choppy research going. He has big shooters now. Why are there morale dropping here? I'm not sure. One Stormboy squad jumping in, the second Stormboy squad jumping in. Shooter Boys losing models, but overall a hold. But heavy losses for IG as well. How is the commandman looking? Still very healthy. Interesting. We'll lose the priest here? No. Okay. The Slugger Boys are used only for capping here now, so you don't want to reinforce them at all. You don't want to lose the orc cap or resource to do so. In the back of this, yeah, he will get another banner. Yes, very, very nice. Very low float from Shakma here. Maybe a little overcommitment here. We will see what he wants to do. He wants. Oh, he focuses down the command squad now. What? He should focus down the listening post and not. Okay, he can do in ranged. I told you. He has two Knob Leaders here. Yeah, two Knob Leaders. No Knob Leader here, but still two Knob Leaders, and they do quite a lot of damage against buildings, you can see here. It is more damage than the Stormboys would deal in ranged, even though the standard Stormboy models would deal more damage in melee. The big discrepancy, I hope it's the right word, from the Knob Leader is quite a lot. He does like around 30 DPS against buildings in range, which is pretty insane. So having the Knob Leader on your Shooter Boy squad would also be helpful. Now this is a really dicey decision here to move in here, but he brings in the second squad here as well. Now has the speed research done for his Stormboys. We will see if he will use it. And he has Choppy now, so you will notice that these guys have Power Claws, you can also hear it. You can also hear if there's a Power Claw going on, so if you hear it, you know, oh crap, SIG probably. Yeah, he killed the turret, which is really nice, and now he should not stay here and take the front, but he will. You could also just kill this listening post here. The Knob Leader will probably die. Yes. This one is still alive, he's in melee. I'm not sure how the Power Claw damage is compared, but oh, really lucky here for a moment, and then there's a big conscript squad. This is one of the misplays Gepiar did in this game here, forgetting about the conscript whole game over there. So one Stormboy squad lost. He also replaces it, okay? He could also decide to go tier 2 instead of replacing it. But he did. Upgraded this one as well. If you want resources, you should upgrade the ones inside your base, because that's the one that are most likely to stay alive whole game. But he has the aggression going on his side yet. Now, oh, we see, now he sees that Kepiar is tier 2. And he is not, but he's only short weight of. Barely. Barely manages to decap the point, but also decap this point here as well. So big, really low income for Gepiar here. Two squads of Stormboys, and now he's tier 2. He gets the custom gadgets. He is tier 2, getting tougher bosses. He's with 40, I think, requiring upgrade. Now can in theory get Knobs, but gets Tank Busters first, which is understandable against Chimeras heading his way. Now we'll see how he fights against Chimeras. He has this he has the stun ability and he has some tank busters on the field soon. There they are. He gets the infiltration upgrade as well. Other than that, he seems to try to buy time, focus the command squad out of here, wait for his tank busters to move in. Does he get another tank buster squad? Only one, okay. But they are really good at dealing with vehicles now that they're infiltrated as well. Only the command squad here, and maybe if Gepiar has the HQ scan ability, but Gepiar would need a tactical control. Ay. Really, really bad fight here. Yeah, he was a little late on the reaction here. Maybe he was focusing something else. Ah, I think these guys dealt with the conscripts, maybe. So now he has tank busters, and the second tank buster squad also on the field. So now two tank busters, and you can use them also to kill buildings, which is really nice if you want to again harass the enemy how should I say, economy. Getting another generator, something probably in preparation for a mech shop. These guys probably want to build a mech shop, but here we see some engagement here. We don't really want to attack the infantry command here. They are now detected by the priest here, so they need to run away. Almost killed the listening post. The storm boys need to jump out. One is already jumped out, finds a little conscript squad here, and the ability to decap if he's that micro good. On the other side he's jumping out. Yeah, he is focusing the conscript and also decapping the relic once again. He now builds the mech shop. I guess he wanted all the whole time, but he was busy microing. He lost the big mech in the process, which is hurts a bit, but he has the eco to rebuild it. Upgrades are basically all done, except for Ducker here. Okay, he gets Ducker. Never. There shouldn't be a game where you do not get Ducker if it's longer than 10 minutes. To tank bus, of course, he decides not to reinforce it as well, because he don't see the need for it now. Gets an op leader on his shooter boy squad, very well needed. And now the question is, what does he get? Go for War Tracks or War Trucks? Very similar names, but very different units. War Trucks. Damage is really good. The accuracy, of course, for orcs isn't the greatest, but if they hit, stun on this Chimera. This one took already quite a lot of damage. Will get stuck here because of the priest, I think, of the command squad. Yes. Now killed. Knob squad out as well. Nice. Now this is a heavy tier 2 push. Even killing them with the storm boys all while this attack was going on, even I didn't notice that, but this is pretty much GG's here. I suppose Gepiar is tier 2 as well, but still. Nobs with Big Mac supported. We remember the mob bonus they will receive, the health bonus, health regeneration bonus, damage bonus, morale bonus and whatnot. They all stack up here. And yeah, there's the war truck with the, what are they called, anti-vehicle boys inside, tank busters. You see, you can keep them at low unit number to preserve pop cap and then still use them for utility causes later on the storm boys. Very, very good in later parts of the game to be a annoying capping tool. We have chimeras here, we have now tank busters shooting the chimera, we have Nob Squad for some reason used in range, which is not the best use because the shooters they have will not receive any bonus from any upgrades, so you want to have the Nobs in melee. They are tanky, you can see them over 11,000 hit points with 12 models, just A-click them. They don't deal the most damage out of all the Orc units, but they are really, really tanky. And if you have them and the Shooter Boy Squad, it's mostly enough. And then you have two tank busters here killing the enemy economy, so this game was over. Nicely played, standard build order. Two Storm Boys are also standard, one shooter. Two Storm Boys, and then in tier 2 you have to decide and adjust on the enemy behavior. Sometimes you can get away with one tank buster and war tracks instead of war trucks. Really depends on the matchup. On the matchup here, on this map, in this match in particular, this was played really well. So with this little explosion here and the Nob Squads, I want to finish my Orky guide. Some guys will probably be a little disappointed that I didn't do the guide in Orky speech, but I'm really bad at it, so hopefully he won't be that disappointed. Okay, if as always, if I forgot something, if I told something wrong, if you want to have to add something yourselves, please write it in the comment questions as well. Next week will be a little different. Thing to talk about, but will be informative nevertheless. As always, guys, thanks for watching and see you in the next video. Bye bye.